I promised some of you that I would tell a story that I never told on television. And there's a reason for it. Certain words in the story that are probably not words I should be using at Carnegie Hall. But I watched Robin Williams at the Met. And, you know, he used those F words 86 fucking times. So I want to tell you the story about my Uncle Yoel. It's a funny name, Yoel, isn't it? It's not Julius, it's not Joel. No. Yoel. It's a perfect... If he walked in here right now and you didn't know who he was, and I say, what do you think his name is? You would say Yoel. He was the dumbest man that ever lived. He didn't care about anything, never read a book, didn't care about anything. But everybody had an Uncle Yoel. Let me do him for you. My Uncle Yoel always looked like he just came out of the men's room. The fly was always unbuttoned. Toilet paper stuck to the heel, sure. I used to walk there. My aunt Sarah used to say, Yoel! He knew right away that the fly was on. It was like a pickoff play at second base. Yoel! He went right there. The minute he'd come to my mother's house on Sunday, the minute he sat in the chair, he'd fall asleep. And then he would break wind and wake himself up. Always blamed it on the dog, the verstunkene Hund. My father hated his guts because he was dumb. He didn't know anything. My father would speak. My father would make speeches. My mother said, no fights, Bernie. My father said, what do you mean, no fights? Man don't know nothing. Talk about the proletariat, the working man, the dignity of the human being. Uncle Yoel had one expression. He wanted to show that he was a real Yankee Doodle Dandy. He'd say, no shit. That's all he ever said, no shit. We used to call him No Shit Yoel. That's all we ever heard him say. We'd play in the hall. I'd be listening at the keel. What'd he do? Uncle Yoel just said, no shit. Pop's going for his throat right now. My Uncle Yoel died. He was 104. Or 105. Who the hell knows how old they were from the old country, you know. I was in London making a film, and I get a call from my brother Eddie. Uncle Yoel died. Well, I was saddened by his death, but I wasn't about to get on a plane and go to the funeral the next morning, because you may know that in the Jewish religion, we bury our dead before the next sunset, which is civilized, you know. I mean, what's the sense of keeping them around? They ain't gonna get no better, you know. If anything, they start to stink. I called my mother in Florida to offer my condolence. She's crying, you know, my mother cries. I said, Ma, you gotta understand, 104, he lived a good life. Can't tell a sister that he lived a good life. Crying, I can't deal with it. I get my father on the phone. I said, what's going on? Mom's really broken up. He says, no, she's not going to the funeral. I said, what do you mean she's not going to the funeral? He said, well, she heard about the children, the ceremony. I don't know about your family, but in my family, whether it was good times or bad times, nobody got along. Everybody was fighting. There was so much hate. Maybe that was love. I don't know. If it was a wedding, I'm not sitting at a table with that son of a bitch. He owes me money since 1934. I hope he has a stroke on the cocktail. And if it was a funeral, I'm not sitting in the eighth car. I should be in the first car instead of his wife, that whore. I said, what's going on? He said, they're not going to have a rabbi at the funeral and Mom won't go. If you think my Uncle Yoel was an idiot, you should have seen the kids he had. My wife gets on the phone. My wife knows how to deal with my mother. She says, Ma, don't worry about a thing. She says, you pack your bag and you go to the funeral in New York. Alan is going to straighten it all up. What am I going to say? I don't give a goddamn how they bury him. Give him a Chicago funeral. Throw him out of a moving car. What do you want from me? I'm not going to New York. She says, it's for your mother. It's always for your mother, the goat. I call my brothers on the phone. I said, get a rabbi. I'm coming in tomorrow morning on British Air, 7:30. I want the rabbi at the airport. There'll be a rabbi at Uncle Yoel's funeral. It's for Mom. I've been drinking on a plane all night. I get off the plane. Two of my brothers are there. Where's the rabbi? They said, the young man over there. Young man? He was 12. Was that big with a dark blue double-breasted with Nike sneakers and a Cannon hat he had on. So where the hell did you find him? They said, the last minute. What do you mean, the last minute? A rabbi's got to look like a rabbi. Mom's not going to believe that's a rabbi. What's his name? He said Chuck. Chuck? Rabbi Chuck! I said, get in the car. We go to Riverside Memorial Chapel. I explained the family situation. Miss King, what kind of service would you like? I said, an Orthodox service. It's for my mother. He said, Miss King, will you deliver the eulogy? No, you do the whole thing, but do it fast. I want to get the hell out of here. I got to go back to London. What my Uncle Yerl couldn't do in 104 years, the rabbi decided to do for him in an hour. He was going to make him great. Abe Lincoln didn't get a funeral service like my Uncle Yerl. And the rabbi didn't even know him. He never even saw him. It could have been a cocker spaniel laying in a box that was closed. Ashes to ashes and dust to dust. A man is born, and he lives, and then he dies. And everyone says, make it fast, Rabbi. Is there no time for a tear? Is there no time to mourn? Is there no time to reflect? A man lived, and now he's dead. A student of the Talmud. A son of the Torah. A man who asked the big questions, how and why and where and when and how. My father stood up and said, no shit. My father waited 60 years for that one moment. It was the funniest funeral I ever went to in my life. They carried me out with my Uncle Yoel. I was on the floor. I said, you hear what Pop said? He said, no shit. He really did.